Perfect Master, Fifth Degree. Summary. Industry and honesty are homely virtues that become a perfect master. Life is far too short and fleeting to waste time in idleness, follies, or dissipation. To learn and to do combine and develop the potential human soul with inherent force and power. Satan finds mischief for idle hands. Honesty still is the best policy, and an honest man still is the noblest work of God. This virtue should be reflected in contracts, business dealings, payment for services, and acceptance of an honest day's pay only for an honest day's work. So live and deal and act that when you go before God, no man was poorer because you were richer. No man had less rank, influence, reputation, or affection because you had more. Commentary. In this degree, we witness solemn preparations for a more decent interment of the Grand Master. King Solomon ordered the remains brought to the temple and a suitable tomb erected as befitted the eminent virtues of the Grand Master. Funeral orations of King Solomon and King Hiram of Tyre expressed grateful tributes to the departed as a man of great abilities in many fields and the central character of the Hiramic legend. His life also symbolized the virtues of industry, honesty, charity, freedom, and spiritual power. Examples of the lost symbol abound in unselfish, vital contributions to humanity. Consider the mother who became lost in a blizzard while carrying her baby over the hills of South Wales. A search party found her frozen to death beneath the snow. Surprisingly, she had on no outer garments. They soon discovered why. She had wrapped these around her baby. When they unwrapped the child, he was alive and well. He grew up to be Prime Minister of Great Britain during World War I, one of England's great statesmen. His mother had given her life to save David Lloyd George. Another woman also had the key to the Master's word. Dressed in rags, she was passing along the streets of a French town, holding by the hand her barefoot little boy. Suddenly she stopped to pick up an object from the ground, tucking it quickly within the folds of her ragged garments. In so doing, she aroused the suspicions of a nearby policeman. He rudely demanded that she show him what she had concealed. The poor frightened woman cast down her eyes and revealed the jagged fragment of a broken bottle. She said, "I was thinking only of the barefoot children." The setting and symbolic color for this degree remind us that while we die in sin, we may revive in virtue. We therefore always should act with regard to justice, equity, honesty, and integrity, and reaffirm our abiding belief in the immortality of the soul. Thus, we symbolically raise the departed from the coffin and place him at the holy altar as a perfect master. A glance upward at the stars and the heavens may strengthen our faith. As Longfellow tells us in Evangeline, "Silently, one by one, in the infinite meadows of heaven, blossomed the lovely stars, the forget-me-nots of the angels." The universe is creating continually. As we participate in the process, we partake of the Creator, the Divine of God. This participation as co-creator is itself a form of man's immortality, regardless of whether, as we believe, his spirit survives the body. We exist and create. Being greater than self is man's true destiny, dignity, and grandeur. Man's will to believe in something greater than self is the springboard from which we can touch the Divine. Talk with men of faith. Read the books that tell of spiritual achievements. Meditate as you gaze at the stars of the first magnitude. Then you too may attain that conclusive spiritual revelation which is the highest human development. So also should we conduct ourselves on the assumption of life after death. The folly of not preparing is told in the tale of a king who sent his beloved jester, Wamba, on a journey. "Go abroad," he said, "and see all that there is to be seen. Take with you this golden wand, and if you meet a greater fool than yourself, present it to him." On his return, Wamba found the king in his last illness. "I too am going on a long journey," said the king, "an even longer one than yours." "Are all your preparations made?" asked Wamba. "No," answered the king. "I have made no preparations." "Then surely," said Wamba, "it is to you I must give the golden wand."